Good evening, and welcome to Driver's Ed. I am having technical difficulties, and I can't find my program to bring up. So this may just take me just a little bit of time. Can anybody hear me? Yeah, I'm having a... All right. Well, good evening. Like I said, I'm having a difficult time tonight with this particular program, so I may have to get out of it to get back into it. But I'm going to fool with it for just a little bit. So just kind of bear with me while I try to find the program. Okay, I'm going to try to get out of this. So I'm going to shut this down and rejoin back in probably in about, let's say in 2 or 3 minutes. So I'm gonna try to shut this down. Oh, maybe that stopped. Okay, hold on. Okay, I found it. I'm back on. There we go. Okay, we're good. We're good. Let me get to the camera. Okay, so let's just talk about last week's class. We ended up about knowing your vehicle. Some of you did do the Facebook worksheets that I had. Make sure you get those in. I really want you to be familiar with your vehicle. What is required for oil, gasoline, tank size of the tire, bulbs, fuses. All these are things for maintenance. Really important that you have a basic understanding of the vehicle that you're going to be driving. So please try to get that in. For today, we're going to be talking about seat belts, airbags, and helmets. So about safety devices on a vehicle. The homework for tonight will be either a poster that you can do. It has to have two facts from information that we talk about tonight or what you gather from researching on YouTube or the internet sometime tomorrow. Just make sure that you get it in. So a poster with two facts, get some graphics, some color on it. All you got to do is take a picture of it and send it along. It should be just on a regular piece of paper. So just draw it out, give me the facts, two facts, some graphics, and then you're going to be good to go. If you really want to be ambitious and do a video, I will give you extra credit on your final, or if you have a missed homework or something like that. Let me show you one of the videos that one of my students did for me. Well, probably about 8 years ago. Let me show you this video.
All right, Violet, time for school.
Yeah, what song?
You know what.
Da 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 da. It's the one and only Deagle Double G.
Snoop Dogg. Snoop Dogg.
Da 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 da. You know I'm mobbing with the D R E.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You know the West Coast is back for all you suckers.
What? Yeah, I'm burning it up. DPGC, you should be talking.
So I thought he did a very good job. He didn't have, where's the microphone? So he didn't provide the two facts, but he did a very good job with the video. And here's one from my last class.
I know, I'm moving.
You're always late. You're
I'm sorry that I... You're just not going to wear your seatbelt?
I don't need to wear a seatbelt. I'm literally a good...
Just as many people die in car accidents because they're not wearing seatbelts.
We literally have to get to school. We're late. You know I'm a good driver. You stop acting so smart.
Bruh, did you hear that? Like, their whole point is to prevent drivers from being ejected from the vehicles during car crashes. You're 30 times more likely to be ejected from a vehicle during a crash if you're not wearing your seatbelt.
So that was from my last class. So I'm going to give you the two options. You can either do the poster, two facts, some graphics, be pretty easy. You should be able to get it out in, let's say, 10 minutes, 15 minutes max. The video is going to take you a little bit longer, so that's why I'm going to give you extra credit on things that we have to do. So if you do the effort, I'm going to reward you for that. So that is another option for you. So let's get right into the PowerPoint for today. So get out a piece of paper. Let's take some notes. We've got some stats that I'm going to include in tonight's presentation that I want you to be familiar with. So what is the real story behind seatbelts, airbags, and helmets? How do we change behavior and attitudes around these subjects? Most of the time, laws are written when we have statistics showing that we're starting a trend one way or the other. So it could be a positive trend where people are taking the initiative to be in their seatbelt, or they're wearing their helmet, whether it be a motorcycle or a bicycle. And we don't need to have a law. But if it looks like we're going in the opposite direction, that's where we get an introduction to legislation on having laws changed according to what the numbers say. Now, how has safety actually changed over the years? Now, your parents are still probably pretty young. They were probably born, late 60s, early 70s, and there were seatbelts in cars back then. But if you were to go back to the 50s, so this was probably taken in the late 50s, early 60s, this is how parents used to secure their child in the automobile. Now, I think we all can agree that metal bars being exposed with no cushion, it looks like it's just a regular type of nylon belt. That's not going to help the child at all. It will keep the child from maybe scooting around inside the vehicle, but any quick, sudden stopping or any type of a crash, it's not going to help the child at all in this situation. So let's talk about what is the problem. Okay, who is least likely to wear a seatbelt? We have found that young adults ages 18 to 24 are less likely to wear a seatbelt than any other age group. Your age group is driving all legislation, whether it be on safety, distracted driving, new laws with licensing, that your numbers, when they start to get negative, everybody's in an uproar in these state legislatures that are saying, we've got to change what is happening to our young people. They're not listening to us. They're not changing their behavior, their attitudes, so we're going to impose laws. We find that men are more likely not to be wearing their seatbelts. In your notes, what I want you to write down, this is the basis of insurance rates. Whatever we have for crash rates, men are higher than women. Thus, that's why we have insurance rates higher for males than females. Where you live, we find that adults in rural areas are less likely to wear seatbelts than those that are in metropolitan areas. I think the basis of this is a few things. One, we're in a familiar area. We don't think we're going to be involved in a crash, so why should I be wearing a seatbelt? I'm only going 3 miles. I may only encounter 15 cars on the road. Whereas if you lived in the city, in a half mile to a mile, you may go by 200, 300 automobiles. So it's not that you're afraid of what you're going to do, which would cause you to wear a seatbelt. You're afraid of what other people are going to do to you, so you're going to wear your seatbelt. I think that is the main reason. Seatbelt use in lower states with secondary enforcement, seatbelt laws or no seatbelt laws, 86% in 2017 compared to states with primary enforcement laws to 91% in 2017. So let's just talk about this for a second. Let me just kind of go through the next slide here. It's going to come up in another slide, so I'll get back to that primary and secondary in a moment. I do want to point this out. We are in a position to see our laws change soon. New Hampshire is the only state in the country that does not have mandatory seatbelt laws for those older than 18 in the front seat. We're the only state. And if you look at this graph, which I know it's kind of old, 2012, only 67 to 78% of people in New Hampshire and Massachusetts, you can tell by the color code, wear seatbelts. We've got to push that number up higher. We've got to get in the 90s somehow. I was driving with a student around Durham last week, and we encountered two of my past students doing a seatbelt survey. They were on the side of the road with a clipboard, watching people go by and tallying down who was wearing a seatbelt and who wasn't. I asked them, I texted them because I still had them in my contact list. I said, I really would like to see the statistics on that. And they said they tried to do their best to get it to me, but she said it might be a couple months before they would have any hard data. But it's still important to know. Okay, here's the slide that I was talking about earlier. So I do want you to write this down. I do want you to know this. Don't be surprised if you see this coming up on a test. What are traffic laws? Laws can be broken down into two categories. One is primary traffic laws. The other is secondary traffic laws. So most traffic violation laws are what we call primary, which means that if a police officer sees you going above the speed limit and he has you detected by a radar or a laser, they're going to pull you over and give you a ticket for speeding. Okay, so that's a primary. They saw it. They have indication that it's to be true. They're going to pull you over. Now, secondary, and this is where seatbelt laws come into play. They have to pull you over for another reason. So they would have to pull you over for speeding to give you a ticket for not having your seatbelt on. Okay, so if a police officer saw a minor drive around without a seatbelt on, he could pull you over. Okay, there's a primary law for seatbelts for under the age of 18. But in another state, okay, like Massachusetts, I believe, it's a secondary law. So everybody has to be belted, but they're only going to give you that ticket if they pulled you over for another reason. So they're not just pulling people over just because you don't have your seatbelt on, if that makes any sense at all. Okay, what is the impact of seatbelt use? Okay, you could use this on your poster if you wanted to. We know that seatbelts reduce serious crash-related injuries by about half. You're more than likely to survive crashes above 40 miles per hour if you're in a seatbelt. If you're in a crash over 40 miles per hour and you don't have your seatbelt on, injuries would probably be sustained, and there's a likelihood that death could happen. If people were in seatbelts back in 2016, we believe we could have saved 15,000 lives. That's a lot of people. And airbags provide added protection, but are not substitute for seatbelts. So a lot of people think, I'm not going to wear my seatbelt because I know my car has like 5 airbags. Has them in the driver's side, passenger side, has one on the ceiling, and it has it on the side, left side, right side, near the seatbelt post. So a lot of people are taking that laxed attitude about having their seatbelt on just because they think my car is safe enough. I have a very good safety rated vehicle. I've got airbags. I'm a good driver. I'm not going too far. And we start to justify our behavior. So what do we need to do? How can we actually start changing the perception? And I'll tell you, when I was your age, when I was in driver's ed, when I first got my license, I didn't wear my seatbelt all the time. But when I got out of college, I worked for a military base. And before they would even let you on the base, you had to have your seatbelt on. So my attitude and behavior changed according to what I knew was required of me. And I think a lot of people are followers of law. If we know it's a law, we want to follow it. Other people believe, you know, like the New Hampshire motto, live free or die. You don't want to do something unless you absolutely have to, and then you're going to be kicking and screaming the whole time. So what can the states do to improve their strategies for making people want to wear their seatbelts? And I think one of the main ones is to make it a primary offense. Take it away from being secondary. Make it to, oh, there's an echo. Okay, I'll try to find a mic. Okay, how about now? Can you hear it now? Someone tell me if you can still hear an echo now. What can health professionals do? What they try to do is to encourage people to, when they come in for checkups, to make sure that they know the dangers of not wearing a seatbelt. Parents and caregivers can use seatbelts on every trip, no matter how short. Be an example. We tend to model behavior of those that are around us. Sometimes people, when it comes to carrying young children around, they don't put them in a car seat, strap them up because they can't either find the car seat, they can't find where the latch is, and they get frustrated and they just don't do it. But always try to be in the best position when you drive, meaning everybody is safe. Don't rush where you are not thinking about safety. You have to have that paramount in your thinking. Okay, it's good now. Thanks. Okay. Sometimes I don't know why tonight is so glitchy. I downloaded an update to this program, and I think the update is worse than what I had before. So hopefully I'll try to make some further corrections. The CDC, just like we know the CDC by the coronavirus, we see it on the news all the time, but you probably didn't know the CDC has a big factor in seatbelt use. They are a big proponent of safety measures in an automobile, because we believe that public safety is, or car safety is public safety. So there is a big factor here. I really want you to take a look at the bottom circles where it talks about restraint use, that the percentage of drivers in the front seat while wearing seatbelts, we are below the national average. And as we learned with the HTS, where federal money is being pushed to states to help make our roads safer, we only get those funds from the national level if we can pass certain standards on seatbelt use. And we are low. And as you can see, 69%, we're basically like, looks like, what's that, 17? Yeah, 17 percentage points below the national average. So as I said, in the high 80s, low 90s is what we're pushing for. But the nice thing that we have going for us is if you look at the top where it says people that have died in motor vehicle crashes in New Hampshire, we're only 919, which is still high, but that's for looks like a 9-year period. And other states, and I think I have a graph for other states. Oh, this is the new law. This is what I want you to write down so you have a basic understanding of this. New Hampshire is trying to change their seatbelt law. It's just passed the House Transportation Committee by a 10-9 vote. This was in February, just before the virus broke out. And I think they haven't heard the rest of this bill. So this could be coming down the pike probably, I'm going to say, this fall or the first of the year. So we may see some changes just about the time that you get your license. So what I want you to write down, they're going to fine drivers $50 and $25 for adult passengers not wearing seatbelts. So we're going to see it move to a primary offense, and the fee structure will be $50 and $25. They're really trying to fine you more to change the behavior of young people. And notice it says school buses and large passenger vans would be exempt. So, the bill was amended to make a failure to wear a seatbelt a secondary offense. Meanwhile, police must have another reason to pull. So they just changed it from a primary, so it's going to keep it down to a secondary offense. So those fine schedules would be, if they pull you over for speeding and you don't have your seatbelt on, then that is the fine schedule. So that's how laws are passed here in New Hampshire. So this is what's happening right now. So this is all current information. I found this on YouTube. I got a couple of things I'm going to show you from YouTube that I pulled into tonight's presentation. I always like to try to keep things current and topical, because it's more than just me talking and it's more than just facts. This doesn't have any pictures. This is only going to be a written statement of what actually happened in this particular state. But I believe like 6 or 7 lives, people died in cars within like a 6-day period. I mean, this state was just hammered with deaths within a very short period of time. So let me show you this.
Please consider your safety in your travels. Do you need to be on the roadways? How are you driving your vehicle? What are you doing to keep yourself as safe as you can for what can be taking place around you? Be safe, everyone.
How about now? Okay, now maybe you can hear me now. This is why they provide PSAs. This is what they show on the local TV. This is going to give you some idea of what is happening in the state. So PSAs are very important. And actually, the video that I showed you last from my last class, I tried to submit that to a New Hampshire organization that was going to look for a new PSA for New Hampshire. We just couldn't logistically sign off on a few things. We had to document that everybody in the video. Oh, you can't hear me? All right, let's see if I can. All right, how about now? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now? All right, let me show you another video about being thrown from a car. Let me get out of. All right, you can hear me now? Just make sure now, watch in the video. Okay, what's going to happen is right here. That is a person being thrown from a video from the vehicle. I'll replay this. Okay, let me show you this one more time. Let me move this back. Okay, you're driving on a highway, and in front of you you have open roads. Okay. Nothing really is of concern, but what you're going to see at the underpass, let me get right here to the underpass. Okay, right now, right there, a car got clipped in the back, which threw out the back end. See, right there. It got clipped, threw out the back end, crossed over. The car that it hit with, that was in front of us, is now going to speed out of control, hit another car head on. Now what you'll see, that is a person. That is a person being thrown from a car. That is a person probably 30 feet up in the air. All because they didn't have their seatbelt on. Okay? Being belted is so important. So important. You don't want to be thrown from an automobile. And you think that it wouldn't happen, but it happens more often than you think. And this is why you want everybody, and that's why you want to basically lock your doors too, because anytime that your door is not locked, there's a chance that the frame of the vehicle is going to start to bend. So when you're hit, if a door pops open, any passenger or yourself that's not belted is going to be thrown from that vehicle. What I want you to write down in your notes, what's going to happen to my body even if I'm in a seatbelt? Okay, this is even in a seatbelt. This is the movement of your body. And let me kind of get out of here for a second. You need to understand that when you have the harness on, there is a little slack. So there is going to be a forward motion and then you're coming back. And if you have the headrest just right, it's going to keep your head from going back, but there is going to be some movement, and what we call that is ride down. So I want you to write down the word ride down. Your body basically gets pushed 1.9 feet at 30 miles per hour. That's if you're an average male between 150 and 180 pounds. So we call that a ride down, which means that your body's being forced up against the belt and it's not going any further than that. Then it comes back up against the seat. So 1.9 at 30 with your head, 1.3 at 30 for your chest, and 1.2 at 30 miles per hour for your pelvis. This is another reason why you do not want to be any closer to your steering column. And if you watch the video that I told you to watch in last class, after we got done class last Thursday, I told you I had made a video, watch it. And I showed you that distance, about 10 to 12 inches you need from your chest to the steering column for the airbag to fully inflate and to do its job. So just make sure you know in your notes, 10 to 12 inches is what we need for that ride down. This is what a car back in the 90s would look like if it was crashed into. Luckily, cars aren't built this poorly anymore. I'd hate to tell you what type of vehicle this is, but it is an American vehicle. And if you were driving this car, even though it was at 27 miles per hour, which is pretty slow, I mean, that's an in-town crash, your leg would probably be mangled or broken. The passenger compartment should not be that beat up. We're building our frames a little bit more sturdy. You should be more intact. And that's what we want. We want the car to crumple, to absorb a lot of the impact in a crash. We don't want your body to handle the brunt of a crash. And when it comes to airbags, you don't have to write these down, but I just wanted to show you inside a car the factors that go into saving your life when it comes to activation of an airbag. So there is a sensor to the front of the vehicle right underneath the headlights, and it sends a signal up to the steering column or over on the passenger side where an airbag will be ignited. And it's like a bomb. It just pops. It just comes out like in 2/1000ths of a second. It's like the flutter of a bird's wing. I mean, it's extremely fast. The airbag inflates, and then there are openings in the bag that will help the air being forced out from the impact of your body. And your body is hitting that airbag. And like we said before, it's called ride down, where you're basically just cushioning inside that airbag. So there is no blunt force with your head or your upper body. The head restraint, we'll talk a little bit later tonight, should be adjusted correctly so your head doesn't snap over the top. If you've got your shoulder belt connected correctly, look at the harness where it's connected to the car. Make sure that it's going across your shoulder and your collarbone, that it's not too low, and you never put a seatbelt underneath your arm. And I'm sure that some of you probably did that at some point. So let's take a look at airbags. And also, what I want you to do in the text message for comments, I want you to write down the safety devices at the end of the video that is going to help you when someone is left inside the vehicle and when there's a bicycle that comes up on the side of your car. So they're talking about two other features. Now, this is an Australian video, and I believe this technology, if it's in Australia, we have it here. We just don't have it in our vehicles right now. So this is new technology that I think that you will see within the next year or two here in the United States. They're probably still trying to do a couple more tests before they implement it. But what they talk about, I want you to put in the comments at the end of the video.
Not only does it ruin your day, but it can leave you with serious injuries or much worse. A proliferation of people refusing to wear seatbelts in the United States back in the 70s led to car makers designing better safety systems to stop natural selection from wiping out a population. And they were called airbags. Today, airbags are one of the most common safety features you'll find in a new car. But how exactly do they work?
In simple terms, airbags are tightly packed nylon bags designed to inflate within milliseconds of an impact occurring, stopping your head and body from hitting points around the vehicle like the steering wheel, windows, or other hard points, which can cause serious damage.
Sensors around the vehicle are able to detect an impact force, like another vehicle hitting yours, sending an electronic message to deploy whichever airbags are needed to protect occupants. The car is able to work out whether the impact is significant enough, as the force of the airbag deploying may do more harm than good in a low-speed accident. While early airbags were designed purely to protect the driver, most new cars have an array of airbags spread out every occupant.
The Santa Fe we have here has 6 airbags, one in the steering wheel, one in the passenger side dash, one in either of the front seats, and curtain airbags that cover all 3 rows.
Again, because airbags deploy with force, you can do yourself serious damage if your arms get in the way or if you're simply sitting too close.
Once upon a time, the correct way to hold the steering wheel was at a 10 and 2 position. But driving instructors now say the best position is a 9 and 3, so the airbags have enough room to deploy without causing serious damage by having your arms in the way.
But there's more to occupant safety than just airbags. Cyclist and pedestrian detection systems are another important safety feature that you'll hear more about in the future. In the Santa Fe, it's called Side Exit Assist. If an occupant attempts to open the door while vehicles, cyclists, or in our case, someone on a skateboard is close by, the system will sound an alarm and in some cases prevent the door from being unlocked. The system also reminds the driver to check surroundings are safe before unlocking passenger doors. If you do open the door while a hazard is detected, you'll get this warning. Finally, we have child presence detection systems. So far, Hyundai is the first car maker to introduce the tech, reminding drivers to check the rear seats before exiting the vehicle. It's called Rear Occupant Alert. The system uses sensors in the ceiling to detect movement after the vehicle has been locked. It stays active for 24 hours and will sound the car's alarm if it thinks you've left someone behind. If you've installed Hyundai's AutoLink app on your smartphone, you'll also receive a text if you haven't tended to the car alarm. Just as airbags can save you in the case of an accident, car makers are constantly developing tech like Side Exit Assist and Re-Occupant Alert to prevent accidents happening in the first place.
So how cool is that? That's pretty cool that it can detect someone that's been left unattended in the back seat. And it also can detect when there's bicycles coming up on to the side. So that's new technology. That's something that we're going to see here in the United States, I'm sure, quite soon. Two terms that I want you to be familiar with. One is passive. The other is active. Passive means automatic. So your airbag is a passive restraint. You don't have to do anything but to buy a vehicle that has airbags. This is the best type of vehicle to have. You really want to make sure that your vehicle has airbags. Now, all cars have airbags now. It's kind of a mandatory standard equipment feature. But if you're looking for a used car that's like 15 years old, you may start to see where some may not have had them. Or maybe they don't have it on the passenger side. Now, active is your seatbelt or your lap belt. This is where you manually have to put them on yourself. So you've got to have the whereabouts to know that you got to have your seatbelt on. So you got to remember every single time that you get into your car that you're going to put your seatbelt on. Airbags are only effective if your seatbelt is worn. That means that if you're being pushed away from the steering column, you're taking a turn too fast, the airbag's going to deploy while your body is up against the window on a left-hand turn, and it's going to be over to the side if it's on a right-hand turn. Try not to have passengers under 12 years of age in the front seat. Airbags will protect your head and your chest from injuries. Drivers should try to keep that 10 to 12 inches clearance between the chest and the steering wheel. We talked about that. And raise the power seat to a position that will allow you to get the full benefit of where the airbag is being deployed. So some of you, no one from your class has driven yet, but someone from the last class, it was almost like they were reaching up for the steering wheel. They were sitting way, way too low, and the airbag would have not been that much help to them if we had a car crash. So make sure your body is lifted up so you're sitting up in an upright position to get the benefit of the airbag. Also notice that on the side of your door, the door frame, the window is going to have airbags that come out. That way you're not hitting your head, or if there's broken glass, the glass isn't coming towards your head. Let's talk about what to do with your feet if you're a passenger. We are in the summer months right now, so it's very common to be driving and to look at cars go by, and you can see people with their legs stuck out the window. Think about it. If that person that was driving had their left foot on the side mirror, what would happen on a front crash or a T-bone? You know, your legs would split. You'd be like a wishbone. You know, your legs going to get pushed out. Don't have your legs where they're not supposed to be. So I thought this was kind of interesting that an airbag comes out at around 100 to 220 miles per hour. So when you ride with your feet on the dash, you may send your knees through your eye sockets. Now, we can probably get a good chuckle out of this, but what would that actually look like? I actually have a picture that will show you what it looks like. Here is a girl who has undergone numerous surgeries that was related to her crash, where she had her feet up on the dash and her knees went up to her forehead. Okay, that is a physical deformity that is not going to get any better. Okay, this is a living example of why not to do it. You know how they say, you know, it's like 1 in 100? Well, here's number one. We don't hear from the other 99, but this is the 1 out of 100. I'm not going to really go over how to put this safety belt on. We've already done that. With the head restraints, do have it basically at the base of your head. So adjust it. It says ear level, but it should be the bottom of your chin. And also have your seat right where it gives you a slight bend to your elbow. And that's going to provide the best protection in a crash. I'm not going to go through the myths and facts. Let's talk about kids, though. I think some of you may have younger brothers or sisters, so it's really important that you understand that once you get your license, if your parents are going to entrust you to, you know, bring your sister and brother around, or if you have a babysit, that you have to take the time and effort to make sure you're just not strapping them in, but you want to make sure that they're secure. There's a difference. Being strapped in and secured are two separate things. Okay, you could strap somebody in and there could be like 6 inches of waist, of slack, okay? That's being strapped in. Secured means there is going to be no movement or very little movement. We talked about your movement in a vehicle going 1.9 feet with your head, 1.3 with your chest. Well, guess what? That same, those numbers apply to a younger person. They're not going to be to that extreme, but it's no different because their weight is different, but their body is still going to move in their child restraint. So if they're at least 40 inches tall, I guess a harness would be acceptable. If it's less than 40, don't put them with that harness. Put them in the back seat with a booster seat. If a child's less than 6 years of age or 50 inches in height, they should have some type of child restraint. And we know that anyone under 18, it's mandatory to be in a seatbelt, okay? But it's that secondary offense. They're not going to pull you over for it because they see that you don't have it on, but if you get caught for speeding and you don't have your seatbelt on, they can write you out another ticket. Secondary offense, just like we talked about tonight. So let's take a look at a video. How do we strap kids into a car? Let's take a look at what that would look like.
More than 1,000 children 12 and under die in car crashes every year, and more than 100,000 are injured. But parents can reduce the risk to their kids if they put them in an appropriate car safety seat that's correctly installed in their vehicle. When a vehicle is moving at 30 miles per hour, so is everything inside it. If the vehicle crashes, unrestrained objects keep moving at their original speed until they strike the vehicle interior. This is why infant and child car seats are so important. They hold child passengers in place as the vehicle's front end does its job of crumpling and absorbing energy. This test demonstrates something parents don't even want to think about: an unprotected infant smashing into the instrument panel. Some parents think it's okay to ride with a child on their lap, but it's not. Crashes happen so fast and are so violent that you can't protect a child this way. Frontal airbags can be especially dangerous. In a crash, an airbag can hit a child or car seat with tremendous force. Even older children shouldn't sit in the front seat. The temptation to play with the radio can put them in harm's way. Children are always safer in the back seat. The basic types of car seats are rear-facing infant seats, forward-facing child seats, convertible seats that can be used either rear or forward-facing, and booster seats for children who've outgrown their forward-facing seat but aren't big enough for adult seat belts. Consider your child's age and size when picking out a car seat, and whether it's compatible with your vehicle's seat and seat belts. Not all car seats will fit well into your vehicle. Proper installation has always been a struggle, but it is getting easier. Since September 2002, passenger vehicles are required to have special anchors, and most car seats have to be made with attachments that fit into them. This system is called latch. Lower attachments mate with anchors in the seat. Anchor points are usually marked. For forward-facing seats, top tethers get attached to anchors on the rear shelf or on vehicle seat backs. Car seats and vehicles without latch are still safe if you use the vehicle's belt system correctly. In order to do this in some vehicles, you may need to use a locking clip. Keep in mind, a car seat that fits easily into one vehicle may not fit very well, if at all, into another. Before you buy a car seat, try it in your vehicle to be sure it's compatible and can be tightly secured. Read the seat and vehicle owner's manuals to make it go more smoothly. In some communities, you can check the installation at county checking stations, police or fire stations, car dealerships, or hospitals. If you're in a severe crash, inspect your child's car seat. If there's visible damage, you'll need to replace it. Remember, your child's safety is up to you. Always be sure he or she is properly buckled in without fail, every ride.
Okay, what I want you to remember from this video is that when you think that there are three positions in the back of a car, really the safest place for a rear-facing car seat, so we're talking a true infant, put down in your notes, is the middle seat. I would even go as far as if you're only carrying one child, you should always have that one child in the middle seat. The reason being, let's just say that I'm in the middle seat. So I have a person next to me here and I have a person next to me here. When a car has been hit on the side, okay, which we call T-bone, all right? Side crash, impact. The impact of your car is going to crumple. It's going to crash, and the force is going to come this way. So if you're in one side or the other, behind the driver or behind the passenger, okay, there's going to be more chance of injury. You have less likely to have injury being in the middle. So who doesn't need to be in a seatbelt? People in a limo. Okay, if you've ever had a chance to be in a limo, you don't need a seatbelt. School buses, and there's a great debate whether that is something that they should try to put into a school bus, but it's been told that bus drivers, in a case of a crash, wouldn't be able to get everybody out. So that's why we don't have seatbelts in school buses. I think they should basically make something where a bus driver could hit a button and it would have all the seatbelts be disengaged. So then all the kids could get out from a crash. Yet they would be safe from the initial impact from a crash. Antique vehicles do not have seatbelts, so they're not required to have them installed. And of course, motorcycles, of course, wouldn't have it. And any handicapped child, probably in a wheelchair that's being secured in a handicapped van where the actual wheelchair is being secured, would not have to be in a seatbelt. So let's talk about motorcycle helmets. And by the way, remember the homework. You could choose a subject to do your poster on: seatbelts, airbags, or helmets. Just do it on one of those subjects. Two facts, stuff that we've talked about tonight, or things that you find online. Make it colorful. Use some graphics. That's due tomorrow. So here's one. New Hampshire has a helmet law for those under 18, but not for those over 18. The only thing that we have required for everybody is eye protection. Eye protection is a must for everybody. So whether you be on a scooter, moped, motorcycle, everybody needs to be with eyeglasses. I thought this was an interesting article. Maybe you will get a laugh out of it like I did. New Hampshire is live free or die. I don't think we'll ever see a mandatory helmet law for those older than 18. New York was thinking about passing a law, so there were protesters on motorcycles doing a rally. And what actually happened is one of the motorcycle riders lost control of his motorcycle. He went over the handlebars, hit his head on the pavement, and he died. That is not good advertisement for your rally of why you should not have to wear helmets. It does just the opposite. It shows why you should have your helmet on. Okay, the guy was 55. I don't know why. He didn't have, I know why he didn't have a helmet on. He was in the rally. But I don't know why he lost control of the bike. So I thought that was interesting. So let's take a look. What happens with helmets? How do we make them safe? Just like with airbags, it's good to know what goes behind the making and the effectiveness of an airbag. Let's take a look about helmets.
A properly fitting helmet is your best choice to protect from serious or even fatal head injury. In fact, a head injury is the most common cause of death for motorcyclists. Helmets are most effective at neutralizing glancing blows rather than dead stop impacts. Thankfully, glancing blows are the norm in crashes.
But if you ran full tilt at a telephone pole, you would exceed the engineering limitations of even the very best helmet.
What we do know from the best studies that in the event of a crash, a motorcycle helmet will reduce your risk of death by 42% and reduce the risk of head injury by 69%.
Here's a breakdown of the areas on a helmet most often damaged in a crash. Studies have shown 3/4 of impact damage happens on the front of helmets. The front, visor and chin bar areas get the most damage, which means over 1/3 of all head injuries, primarily to the face, would not be covered by an open face compared to a full face helmet. This rises to almost 40% for a half shell. Standards and impact testing of all helmet types is incredibly important. We visited Crash Lab in Sydney to better understand the tests they do. The outer shell is the first line of protection. It works with the strap to keep the helmet on your head. It will flex in a crash and may crack. The inner impact absorption layer is the critical stage of defense. It's made up of EPS, better known as expanded polystyrene, The density and thickness of the EPS makes a huge difference to how well it cushions your brain. Newer helmets have low density EPS against your head and harder EPS against the shell, so a relatively minor impact doesn't give you a concussion. The strap is critical for keeping the helmet on your head in a crash. Helmets come off in around 11% of all crashes, which is frightening. This can also happen if the helmet is too big, even when the strap is done up. Proper fit is essential for effective protection.
I mean, it really is just conveying that a motorcycle helmet's going to stop your brain from bouncing around inside your skull when you have a crash.
Head injuries are horrible things, from mild concussions to death. All public health studies tell us that wearing a helmet improves your survival odds significantly.
Systematic reviews, like the study that we did, can't tell you which particular helmets are the best helmets to wear. But if you're wearing a helmet that fits you correctly and is appropriately standard certified, that's going to give you the best protection in the event of a crash.
So do yourself a favour and wear one. You know it makes sense.
I apologise for the little blood and gore, but that is what happens in an emergency room for head trauma. They have to relieve the pressure, so they do have to cut your skull open to relieve some of the pressure. That's the fact of riding a motorcycle without a helmet. I will show you one last clip on helmet use. This was a testimonial from somebody that didn't wear a helmet, became paraplegic, and now he's a proponent of wearing helmets. Let me show you his story of what happened to him. And maybe if you ride motorcycles, maybe this will change your point of view.
Hey YouTube, it's Brian. Today's video I feel is very long overdue. Kind of wanted to talk about my motorcycle accident and more importantly, the helmet that I was wearing in the accident. In 2009, I was pulling out of my work parking lot. I was pulling onto a fairly busy road and there was a bunch of parallel parked cars on the side of the road. So when I pulled out, I turned right and I didn't see an oncoming car that was actually speeding. And right after I pulled out, the road started to curve. So what happened was I pulled out, saw this car coming, floored the bike trying to get out of the way, and got a little too close to the curve, the actual curb of the road. And there were a bunch of trees on the side of the road, and I happened to tip the bike over against the curb and slammed headfirst into a tree. I was doing about 35 miles an hour, not anything crazy fast, but this is what happened to my helmet after the accident. As you can see, I caved in the entire top of the helmet. As a result, this broke my spinal cord, and from the chest level down, I'm now paralyzed. So I know you're probably thinking, you know, why would I want to listen to a guy who was paralyzed talk about helmet safety? Well, there's quite a few reasons. First being that I have zero brain injury. That was the biggest thing. My injury is completely physical, which has allowed me to do a lot of things. Obviously, I can still work. I co-manage a group of over 30 people. I can actually still take care of myself. I can take care of my bathroom routine. I can get myself dressed. I am fully independent. I'm married. I have a beautiful wife. I have a great job. I have, you know, a sports car. I like to autocross my car, which is a form of racing, and I do that quite a bit. I still work on cars. That's something that I've always really loved to do. So there's a lot of things in my life that I don't think I would have been able to do had I had a brain injury. As you can see, I wouldn't have even had that chance had I slammed headfirst into a tree. I would have been completely dead. There was no way that I would be sitting here talking to you today. I actually went through rehab with a guy who had a similar accident. He was going through an intersection on his bike. A car was coming through, ran a red light. He slammed into that car, flipped off his bike, and he didn't have a helmet on, and he hit his head real hard on the concrete. He was not the same guy that he was before. He basically knocked him back to third grade. When he was in rehab, he was tripping over himself. He was rambling. You know, he would just start talking, you know, gibberish. He just wasn't. And that is one thing, the biggest thing, aside from my life, that this helmet has saved is my brain and my personality. When it comes to brain injuries, it can vary as far as what your symptoms are. It's all about where your brain was injured. So those people who have lost complete memory, they actually have to write things down throughout the day to keep track of what they've done. If they went to the bathroom, you know, if they just anything throughout the day, they're actually writing it down. Their speech can be impaired. All these things are preventable from wearing a helmet. There's a lot of people who were married and they ended up getting divorced as a result of their brain injury because, you know, they might be very hard to take care of. Or the other thing is, since their personality is so much different, there's women that have said, you know, this isn't the same man that I married. That is one thing that I feel like I still have. I still have my personality. I'm still the same person. I can still joke. I can still do everything, you know, mentally that I could do before my accident. Obviously, there are some restrictions from a wheelchair, but I've overcome quite a bit of stuff. I even, believe it or not, I even modified my motorcycle to ride post-injury. It had little legs that folded down and a electric shifter. So what I would do is I'd push a button, the legs would fold up out of the way, and I would ride again. So that was one thing right after my injury that really kind of kept my mind out of the dark side. Obviously, I had a couple times where I thought about committing suicide. I didn't think that I could live my life from a wheelchair, or at least not have a quality, you know, life. I've found that that's complete bullshit. I have a great life. You know, like I said, I've got a great wife. I still hang out with friends. I still go on vacation. I still go swimming. I still do pretty much everything that I used to do. I just do it a little bit differently. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. I know people that ride motorcycles are extremely hard-headed. I was one of them. My accident, I thought, you know, if I ever got in an accident that I would break a leg or I would break my arm. I never imagined that I would smash into a tree and be paralyzed. But then again, if I hadn't been wearing the helmet, I would be dead. That would have been end of story for me. And I don't have the brain injury, like I said. So I can still do everything that I did before, just a little bit differently. Another thing I've still been able to do is watch my niece and nephew grow up. Just to see them from a little baby and, you know, the toddlers they are right now. To watch a child grow is just an amazing thing. I think, you know, if I was already a father, there's no way in hell I'd be on a motorcycle myself. But think about that. I mean, if you got killed, who's going to take care of your kids? And do you really want them growing up without a father, or growing up with a father with a brain injury who can't take care of them? I think that is the biggest reason. If you are going to choose to get on a bike, you need to get a helmet and you need to wear it. Don't have it strapped to the side of the bike as you're going down the highway. That's not going to help because anything can happen. That's one thing I've figured out. I took an advanced riding course 2 weeks before my injury. I mean, I was a safe rider. I did everything I thought I should. I wore the full gear, and stuff happens. I mean, it's just how it works, especially these days with everybody on their cell phones constantly. Accidents are everywhere around the corner, and if you're on a motorcycle, you don't have a cage around you. You're not in a car. You don't have an airbag. You're pretty much exposed to anything and everything on the road. So that's really all I wanted to share with you. If you have any questions, write in the comments below, and I'll talk to you soon. Thanks a lot.
I really thought he did a really good job with giving us an idea of what his life was like before and after, and some of the emotions. Because when you have an injury, I'll just say, if you ever have an accident, not an accident, I like the word crash or collision. If you have a crash, even if you're not at fault,
it changes the way that you perceive how you're going to drive the next couple days or the next time that you get behind the wheel of a car. It can be very traumatic. So when it changes your life, like with him physically, it's going to conjure up a lot of depression and negative comments. But he was very well grounded. He seemed to have a good support group to keep him going, a good job, a wife and everything. And he's really been able to turn his life around. And I thought his discussion about why you've got to be watching out for motorcycles. I mean, there are people that are just distracted. So when you're out on the road with your parents or when you get in the car with me, we have to be scanning the roadway for these people. Because a lot of times they do take chances, motorcycles, and they don't have that protection of a helmet. And even though we may not be at fault, and he admitted, he, you know, rushed out, he didn't take his time, didn't see it. So he was, you know, at least partially to blame. But as an automobile driver, that's something you're always going to see in your mind, a motorcycle coming in front of you and you hitting it. So we don't want that to happen. Few more things. Write down the word ramping. We had talked about the headrest meeting the back of your head squarely. This is very important that your head doesn't go over the back of your seat, because that is where you're going to pull all these muscles. So right now I'm sitting in my seat. I'll get a little bit higher. But when the head goes way back and you hyperextend all these muscles will rip away from the bone, all right? And that's basically what whiplash is, is where you rip away the muscles and tendons and ligaments from bone to bone right here on either side. So hitting it back squarely, you don't have a chance to tear all this right here. Because if you had no muscles, ligaments or whatever, your head would just bounce around. So it's really important that everything is square. It's more so for people that are extremely tall, not so much for people that are probably under 5'10". Write this down. We're going to probably see this tomorrow. We're not going to see it today. So in your notes, when you have a collision, there are three collisions that happen when a car goes off the road and let's say hits a wall. All right, so there are three types of collision, and we're going to talk about what are those three collisions tomorrow. I believe the video is around 10 to 12 minutes, so it's a little bit lengthy, so I really don't want to get into that tonight. I just want to touch on a few other things. If you're a parent, why is it important to make sure that your kid is belted? Because if you're in a rush and you say, I'm not going very far, I'll just throw him in the back seat. Here's a father that was driving. If you look down at the very bottom, the second paragraph, the driver of the vehicle will face charges because he was driving on a suspended license and he failed to properly restrain a child. So he wasn't even supposed to be driving. We talked about suspension and revocation. No, that's tomorrow's class. We're going to talk about what is a suspended license. What's a revocated license? But he went around the traffic circle in Alton way too fast and went off the edge of the road. Son wasn't belted. The door probably popped open and the child was thrown from the vehicle. Being 2 years old, I would suspect that it was serious injuries because they had to airlift them to Maine Medical. And by the way, that is not cheap. Just getting a helicopter to bring you somewhere is going to probably be between $75,000 and $100,000. So hopefully you have good insurance. What could happen if everybody's not belted? I think I didn't load that. I don't think I loaded that video. I'll have to remember it tomorrow. This is just a quick little story. I'm not going to read the whole thing. The bottom of it is that in some states they can actually, if you look down at the bottom, it says 2 weeks later, I got 5 tickets in the mail for driving without a seatbelt. So in some states they can actually take your picture if it's a primary offense And if they can see that you're not in your seatbelt, they'll send you your ticket in the mail. But the story just goes that he thought he was being videotaped for speed. But in reality, he was being videotaped because of seatbelts. A couple facts that I want to give you. This used to be in the old manual. I don't believe it's in the new one. It's pretty generic, pretty straightforward. Safety belt use. We talked about this with the state of New Hampshire earlier on. Your chance of survival twice as good as if you weren't buckled. So make sure that you're buckled so you increase that chance of survival. If you add a shoulder harness to it, it increases it 3 to 4 folds. The other benefits of a seatbelt or a shoulder harness is they keep you from moving around at sudden stops and turns. They keep you from in a proper driving posture. They keep you from being thrown from the vehicle. So you're 5 times better to live by staying in your car. And they do slow your body down, as we saw earlier in the graph that I gave you. So the ride down is a benefit of the shoulder harness and the lap belt. So hopefully these are all things that you will think about. I hope that you're not one of those type of people that will get to the age of 18 and say, finally, I'm at 18. I no longer have to wear a safety belt and choose not to do it. Hopefully this is something that you're going to carry on for the rest of your life. And to be honest with you, I don't even think about it anymore. Actually, my wife laughs at me because sometimes right out here, when we have company, I have to park my car out into the road. So I'm only backing up maybe 80 feet, 90 feet. I'll still put my seatbelt on, just backing out of the driveway, cutting across the roadway, and parking on the other side of the street. It's just something that I always do. I don't even think about it anymore. So that's a rundown of the three safety devices that I want you to be thinking about. Tomorrow we're going to be getting into licensing, title, and registration. So read Chapter 2 in Responsible Driving and read Section 2 and 4 in the manual. So we're going to be talking. I'll have to change my presentation a little bit because now that we're in COVID, state licensing is changing a little bit. They'll split it up, but I'll talk more about that tomorrow. It's not your traditional way to get a license anymore. Maybe by the time that you do drive, we'll get back to regular testing, but they have made some changes, and I'll try to bring that into the discussion for tomorrow. There really isn't any questions that you have to answer. Just do the poster, and it'd be cool. Oh, if you do choose to do the video, that is not due tomorrow. That's not until next Monday, so you've got a whole week to do it. And the other thing about the video, just make sure that it's only 30 seconds. I don't want anything too lengthy or takes too much of your time, because what you will find, editing video can be lengthy. Okay, you think you're going to take a quick video and chop it up and do stuff. It always takes me a long time to do some of the videos that I do. So that is a rundown of our discussion of the topic tonight. If you have any questions, and by the way, any questions for any topic that we go over, I still stay on my phone for a bit. So if you want to text me anything, I can get back to you. I don't know about driving maybe coming up. So I'll try to schedule some people maybe in the next week or two. Okay, it's getting a little bit better. I'm getting a few people done. Some people aren't getting back to me. So since I've got you every night, mostly, and you guys want to drive, then I'll slip you in. But I do know I'm pretty packed until Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. I still have some slots, so maybe I'll slide some of you guys into those spots, and we'll start getting behind the wheel and driving. So I think that's it for tonight. We're going to start off tomorrow with that video about the three crashes. We'll talk a little bit about that. And then we'll get right into licensing and titling and registration and inspection and stuff like that. But that is it for tonight. So have a good evening, and we'll see you. Remember, do your worksheet. Okay, know your vehicle. Go to Facebook, know that the two charts for devices, you got to do that too. So make sure the homework is in, because if it's not in, I'm not going to drive with you, or you're not going to be able to take the final. So get that done. All right. Good night. We'll see you tomorrow at 8 o'clock.